Very good morning, everyone in Sawadika. We are very pleased to see you again and would like to thank you for joining us at the last session of SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series today. As of today, the COVID-19 pandemic still remains as a big challenge to all of us. Many students and teachers have not yet returned to the school and they are still using remote learning. Therefore, to maximize the learning opportunities of our students during lockdowns, we as teachers must be responsive, adaptive, and also up to date to the technology so that we can manage our online classroom effectively. Previously, we have presented to you the teacher training solution and innovative teaching solutions. And today, we are pleased to share with you on future skill for students and industrial revolution 4.0 solutions. We hope that you could learn some new ideas from our SEAMEO-Partners lectures today. We are very pleased and thanks to our 20 partners who have shared their innovations and also offers free training courses, learning resources, or free opportunities for all of us, educators and students, to take part in their programs. And we are not forget, we also would like to thank the Ministry of Education in our regions, our 26 SEAMEO centers and networks, as well as all institutions under SEAMEO school networks for promoting our program. We will hope that you will learn a lot from this program, and please don't forget to grab all opportunities offered by our partners as shown in their video clips. Because we are with you, may I know, call and introduce our wonderful host, Mr. Rafi and Ms. Piapa, will be the facilitator of our today's sessions. Mr. Rafi and Ms. Piapa, I'm pleased to turn the floor to you. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wayudi, for that welcome message. A pleasant morning to everyone. I'm Rafi, and Piapa, would you like to greet our participants?
Good morning, everyone, and it is nice to see you again for this morning, for the last session of the SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series.
This is the last for this particular Partners Lecture Series, and we'd like to recognize the more than 537, to be
That's
exact,
right.
those joining us on YouTube. And in the last lecture series, we were joined by more than 42,000 who viewed even after. So that's a consolidated number of those who learned with us in the previous lecture series.
And also the last session, we asked the participants to submit the photos while they are watching our lecture series. So there are many participants who selfie themselves or even they took a photo in a group in front of the video or in front of the television and share with us. So maybe share the photo to them.
Yes, we have a special video presentation based on the submissions that we received. So we value all those photos that you shared with us. So this is just a simple token of gratitude, this video presentation. So friends, let us all enjoy and watch this.
Yes, very exciting to see that photos.
So we'd like to thank all our viewers, all our valued participants who shared their photos to us and tagged and upload them on their official social media channels. Thank you very much. We truly appreciate the time they gave to do this task that we requested of them.
And then the video that we compiled together will be shared on the SEAMEO website as well and also SEAMEO Facebook.
Yes, and feel free to share, retweet them so that you can also spread the news and also learn from the previous presentations that we had of the lecture series.
That's right.
So for today, Piapa, would you like to walk us through the sessions for this lecture series?
Well, for today is the last session. It's very special. And we have about 5 chapters, keynote presentations, and future global citizenship, future skill for workforce, Industry 4.0 and knowledge, and the last one, virtual work experience. And today we have about 10 video clips from 10 partners based from 5 countries from the globe. And then our partners also offer at the end of their presentation, please make sure that you stay with us at the end and grab your mobile, you know, be ready to capture the offering from our partner at the end of their presentation.
I'm sure our participants are very excited to know more about these very innovative technology solutions or capacity building activities that our partners are offering for free to all interested participants.
And this session is special for the students as well. You know more on about the knowledge for the students improvement.
So with that, let's now proceed with the keynote presentation. So we have two keynote presenters. The first one is from the Global Partnership Education. Ms. Ramia Vivekanandan will be talking about Raise Your Hand for Education, GP Investing in Teaching and Learning for 21st Century Skills in Southeast Asia and Beyond. And this will be followed by a presentation from Senior Regional Center for STEM Education Thailand. And they will be talking about enhancing innovation skills through STEM learning with computational thinking. So very interesting video lectures. So friends, let us all learn and enjoy from this.
Please learn from that experience.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you here today, albeit virtually. Thanks so much to SEAMEO for organizing this lecture series. I'd like to start by telling you first a bit about my organization, the Global Partnership for Education. The Global Partnership for Education, or GPE, is the world's only partnership and fund that's focused exclusively on bringing quality education to children in developing countries. As a shared commitment to ending the world's learning crisis, GPE mobilizes partnerships and investment in transforming education systems so that every girl and boy, no matter gender, location, income, or ability, can get a quality education and unlock their full potential. We work for children most in need in 76 low-income countries across the world. Our unique model of convening partners and mobilizing funds behind country leadership achieves lasting impact. We support government efforts to advance teaching and learning for the 21st century. We mobilize more and better financing and work to scale up proven solutions for the world's poorest and hardest to reach girls and boys. Turning to the question of COVID-19 and the role of GPE, as we know, the pandemic triggered an unprecedented learning crisis. GPE is deeply concerned about the millions of children on the margin of education systems who face exclusion, such as refugees, children with special learning needs or disabilities, children from the poorest households, and those living in remote communities. School closures and economic hardships during the pandemic have made these children even more vulnerable. And so that's why GPE rapidly mobilized more than half a billion US dollars to support developing countries to respond and to help prevent a catastrophic loss of learning. As the largest funder supporting the education impacts of COVID-19 in partner countries, GPE is committed to building back better and more resilient education systems. This must include, of course, bridging the connectivity divide in education. Turning to the Asia Pacific region, many of our grants have gone specifically to countries in this part of the world. GPE also partners with countries broadly to strengthen their education systems, including five of the SEAMEO member countries, which are Cambodia, Vietnam, Myanmar, Lao PDR, and Timor-Leste. Indonesia and the Philippines are also eligible for the GPE co-financing grant known as the Multiplier. So for example, in Timor-Leste, the COVID-19 grant has been supporting a virtual library with curriculum-based textbooks and associated materials to reach children who are out of school. In Lao PDR, the GPE grant works to improve the quality of pre-primary and primary education. It provides schools and communities with the tools needed to ensure that all children are in school and reading in the early grades. So, with this background on GPE, allow me now to turn to the heart of today's discussion. How can we best support 21st century skills in Southeast Asia and beyond? For GPE, the answer lies in a strong focus on teaching and learning through everything that we do. That's why in our new strategy, GPE 2025, we affirm to support our partner countries to achieve improvements in learning along each stage of a child's education, including early learning, foundational skills such as literacy, numeracy, socio-emotional learning, and the wider range of cognitive and non-cognitive skills identified as necessary to prepare students for the 21st century. So in terms of teaching and learning, to respond to country needs, we recognize that in low and middle income countries specifically, 53% of all children cannot read and understand a simple story by age 10. There are many dimensions of this challenge. We don't have enough data on learning outcomes, first of all. Yet in more than half of GPE partner countries, we do not have quality learning assessment systems that can produce this data. At the same time, the learning crisis is also a teaching crisis. And across the globe, almost 69 million more teachers are needed to reach the Sustainable Development Goals. This is even more daunting when one considers adequate allocation of teachers and trained teachers specifically. So GPE is responding by investing significantly in supporting its partner countries with teaching and learning. Since June of 2019, GPE has allocated more than $442 million to improve learning. We also share knowledge, resources, and best practices across the partnership and engage in global policy dialogue. For example, in Cambodia, with GPE support, the STEPCAM project is working to strengthen teacher education specifically. Similarly, in Vietnam, the Escuela Nueva project worked to introduce new and child-centered teaching and learning practices in the classroom, targeting the most disadvantaged groups at the primary level. Turning then to 21st century skills, we recognize that learning is about so much more than just reading and mathematics. And last year, GPE published a landscape review. It looked into the role that GPE can play in supporting our partner countries to embed 21st century skills or their equivalent. In some contexts, they're known as soft skills or life skills or transversal competencies or skills to embed these within their education systems. We found that there's been a rich history of work and initiatives at the global level on 21st century skills. Across the partnership, there's been substantial work in the area, but yet there are gaps in terms of research, knowledge sharing, capacity development, and advocacy to advance system-wide implementation in developing countries. Gaps exist also in GPE partner countries, yet at the same time, we found that assessment tools that are applied have the potential to capture these skills. So we're supporting a number of things, such as, for example, in Cambodia, where there are efforts to integrate ICT literacy into teacher training programs by establishing and upgrading ICT training laboratories. This is just one example of how we're supporting one of our partner countries to ensure that 21st century skills are integrated in their system. GPE now stands ready to accompany all of our partner countries to move forward on this agenda in terms of ensuring that their education systems are in fact supporting children and young people to acquire 21st century skills and to ensure that the systems are in fact fit for the 21st century. Turning then to the crucial issue of financing, to unlock the future we want begins by investing in the generation that will build it. It's very simple. That's why GPE launched a financing campaign to keep education a top priority of world leaders, including accelerating efforts in teaching and learning. The financing needs are great, and that's why GPE is calling on world leaders to raise your hand and to pledge at least $5 billion for the next 5 years to help GPE transform education in up to 90 countries, which are home to more than 1 billion children. Recognizing that the pandemic is putting a strain on national economies and budgets, GPE is also calling on leaders in partner countries to protect education expenditure in national budgets. These efforts will culminate in our Global Education Summit in July of this year, hosted by President Kenyatta of Kenya and Prime Minister Boris Johnson of the UK. A successful GPE replenishment will help to ensure that 175 million children can learn, that we can enroll 88 million more children in school, and boost discretionary budgets in low-income partner countries by nearly one-third. In the longer term, this investment could add $164 billion to economies in the developing world, lift 18 million people out of poverty, and protect 2 million girls from early marriage. So please join us by raising your hand for education.
By situating the learning in the real-world context. In our first step, เข้าใจปัญหา, or focusing on the problem, students find out about the impact of the issue. They find out why they need to know about this content. The second step is ศึกษาหาทาง, or explore existing solutions to the problem. It is here that our good old scientific inquiry investigations can be integrated. The students can also learn from reading selected articles or search from the internet for background knowledge related to the solution.
In the third step, สร้างสรรค์ปรับเปลี่ยน, students are challenged to create new solutions or improve on existing ones. This is where they apply their content knowledge to create a better solution. They get to innovate with their friends. Students have meaningful conversations discussing STEM contents. They also practice and improve different skills, describing their ideas in words and in pictures, presenting to their friends. They justify their ideas, listen to evaluate other ideas, and work on improving them. They will also learn that not all ideas will be a success. They will learn to fail and then to try again. Students develop growth mindset, so critical for their future success in innovation economy.
Then we come to the fourth part, สะท้อนเขียน สะท้อนคิด or reflection on the learning. Many STEM activities conclude with the results of the challenge, sharing to the winning team and clapping all around. We want to go further. So in the last part of our STEM Kids lessons, we ask students to reflect on their learning. This can be answering a few questions, discussion on a topic, writing to your future self, creating a Facebook post,thinking about a related STEM career. There are many ways you can get the student to reflect. Please make time for students to reflect on the content they have learned and review the skill that they have grown.
So, where does computational thinking fit into all this? Coding or computer programming is writing a set of instructions that computer can understandTo program, or to tell the computer to perform a task. Everybody should learn to program a computer because it teaches you how to think.
We want to integrate computational thinking into our STEM lessons. We want to enhance students' thinking skills, and we want to do that in context. The first set of STEM Kids lesson was developed under the theme Creating for the Changing World.The computational thinking skills will be foundational to our future innovators. The kids today will solve the world's problems tomorrow.
Computational thinking plays an important part in STEM Kids lessons. In storm chasers, students create a flowchart to characterize a storm using a series of yes or no questions about the storm origin and the maximum wind speed.Before they create the flowchart, we build their skills using a board game where students solve a problem by designing and asking yes or no questions. The students think they are playing, but actually, they are growing computational thinking skills, then put these skills to use when they design a process to characterize a storm. In Heat X Probot,We design several computational thinking integration points. In this lesson, students started by exploring occurrence of heat waves across different places and through time from the past to the future. Students again play with data models, trying to make sense of the data and make decisions based on the projection from the different data models. We ask the students to look atThe historical trends of the heat waves and deadly heat days from the past to present, and then look at the projection of the deadly heat days in different areas when we take no action, with medium mitigation and with strong mitigation.
Data is the new oil. In the future, if you have data and can understand data, then you can power up anything.Information can be extracted from data, just as energy can be converted from oil. This is why students should learn with data.
In HeatWave X Probot, students design a process to collect temperature data over different color surfaces. They then go out in the sun, take the measurements, and realize for themselves the challenges of working in extreme environments.We then shift very naturally and challenge students to design a robot that can collect temperature data for us so that we can stay in the shade.
We use paper coding for students to design how the robot moves. If you don't have high-tech robot in your classroom, don't worry. Coding is the important part.
Teacher training under STEM Kids project uses hands-on, screens-on interactive approach. We also use a model that we call with the nickname Mango Sticky Rice model. The participating teachers switch between instructor's perspective and learner's perspective through the session. Like when you have mango sticky rice, some bites you have sticky rice and some bites you have mangoes.
It is imperative for STEM teacher training to use hands-on approach. And when we conduct training online,It is very important that the screen should be on as well to encourage maximum interactions and maximize sharing and co-learning.
Online training can be really powerful, participants several hundred kilometers away can draw annotation real time on the same diagram. We can collect temperature data from the north, east, south, and central Thailand simultaneously.
There are many cool tech tools to use in the classrooms, but the good practice that we learn is to really spend a good amount of time figuring out the tool and immediately put the tool to use in training activities. There is no use just mentioning the tech tools and hope the teachers will explore in their own time. We know that the teachers are busy with their important work. We must go deep, not just spreading a mile wide and an inch deep, as they say.
Reflection is important, not only for the students. The process is critical in teaching training as well, and even more so for online training. When we introduce the STEM Kids lesson to the teacher in our online training, the first part, we will look at the lessons wearing a teacher's hat. We look at the learning objectives together. We review the alignment with the national standards. We look at key features like learner engagement strategies, assessment, technology use, and skill integrations, including computational thinking skills. Then we go through the activities like we are students, following the progression of their learning, before returning at the end to think about the whole experience as a classroom teacher again. And now taking into account of different and diverse classroom contexts, we can discuss possible adaptations of the STEM Kids lessons for students with different learning abilities, for schools with different tech readiness, or learners with limited reading or math literacy, for example.
A whole day training in front of the screen can be tiring. So please make sure you sit correctly and drink plenty of water. We also have regular breaks and check-in to keep the energy level high.
Meaningful learning happens when students make connections, expand the idea, create, fail, improve, remix, reuse, and have a good time. And it's the same for the teacher too.
That is very interesting presentation from our keynote speakers. And I hope that you learn a lot from the STEM techniques, right, for the primary education. Mm-hmm. And we would like welcome the participants from other countries beyond Southeast Asia to post on the YouTube chat that where you come from, like organization and country.
And country where they're currently in, because we're seeing so many from Southeast Asia and also others from outside Southeast Asia.
Yes, and we'd like to hear from you if you are from India, Pakistan, China, Japan, Korea.
Even US, Europe.
Yes, that's right, or UK. Please post on the YouTube chat that where you come from and what the country. All right, that thank you very much for your cooperation. And the next one, we have the Future Global Citizenship chapter. And for this chapter, we have two partners sharing on the different programs. And the first one from Education University of Hong Kong, and we'll give you the idea on the skill need for the 21st century and the framework. And the next presenter is from AIT Thailand, Dr. Thammarat. We give another view on the environmental perspective, which is very important for our students and teachers. Okay, please learn from them.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues. I'm privileged to deliver a speech for the SEAMEO Partners Lecture Series with the theme called Education 21st Century Skills and Promoting Live Education for Future Citizens. While I come from Education University of Hong Kong, however, this speech represents my personal views only. So I will try to give you, first of all, because I'm speaking for SEAMEO community. Actually, as you may, many of you may have noticed, the SEAMEO have launched various education awards related primarily to education for sustainable development and also other areas. As you can see this slide, there's also activities related to various education and global citizenship. And we are going to have a SEAMEO Congress 2021. And one, you can see the sub-themes here. These are the, I must say, the themes that are very important for future, like people transformation, digital transformation, sustainable communities, quality education, STEM education, and so on. So this will provide context for us and for future development. So according to SEAMEO, one of the priority areas is to have the adoption of a 21st century curriculum. So I speak a little bit on the 21st century skills later on. You can see also some reports related to analysis of 21st century skills in different parts of the world, including the Philippines and so on. So apart from SEAMEO, we have also the OECD Future of Education Skills 2030, the conceptual learning framework. So I will highlight a few things, like when you talk about values, we talk about personal values, social values, societal values, human values. And some of the example values are emphasized, like human dignity, respect, equality, justice, responsibility, global mindedness, cultural diversity, freedom, tolerance, and democracy. So this will provide some examples for us to reflect on and to consider including. We'll talk about values and skills that we can make reference to. So I would like to draw our colleagues' attention about the history, briefly the history of 21st century skills. I refer, first of all, back to 2009, the framework called P21, the Partnership for 21st Century Skills, put forward. Somebody calls it, sometimes called the rainbow model. So you can see the range of skills and also the approach with themes as well. So you can see that some themes are ranging from global awareness, financial, economic, business, and entrepreneurship, and literacy, civic literacy, health literacy, and environmental literacy, just to give you some examples and feel of the situation. We have also life and career skills, learning and innovation skills, information media and technology skills. Some colleagues and scholars may refer to 21st century education using a term called meta-learning. Meta-learning, of course, sometimes referred to metacognition growth mindset, which integrates values and characters on one hand, knowledge and skill on the others. For UNESCO, UNESCO put forward the five pillars of lifelong learning. And recently, also UNESCO explores the general theme called learning to become. So this is the basis when we talk about 21st century education, 21st century skills, and then often we refer to the notion of 21st century learner, which you can see are really a wide array of qualities, and also they perform or behave like a effective learner and effective collaborator, and also an effective communicator and creator. So this serves the background for 21st century education and 21st century skills and how they might embed values. In Hong Kong, we also talks about life education through the chief executive, Ms. Carrie Lam. And also there's a recently announcement of the task force on review of school curriculum final report. And in that, high priority to various education, including life education, moral civic and national education, life planning education will be accorded a high priority. Recently, there's also an emphasis on empathy and law abundance. So you can see that from 2014 to now 2020, there's a range of values or attributes to be emphasized in a school curriculum and possibly links with life education in the Hong Kong context. So this is the diagram from the EDB document showing the connections of various education, among which life education is one of them. So you can see that different values education are connected and contributing towards whole person development. Our president, Professor Stephen Zhang, has also written an article in 2019 on his personal reflection on life education. And because of the Chinese context, Professor Zhang emphasized, President Zhang emphasized Renai being the benevolence as a basis for the Chinese-oriented life education. In UNESCO, you also find a humanistic vision of education development. So it comes back to what is life education. Life education basically is to foster student continuous personal growth and lifelong learning, strengthen ability to cope with the changing context, and also to resist unethical behavior from temptation of today's world, and also make people being, you know, physically, emotionally, intellectually, religiously, and morally competent, and also performing in a positive light. There are five education approaches of life education. So you can enter through religious angle, a physiological health angle, psychological angle, career life planning perspective, social life approach, and also may consider the linkage with life and death education approach. I won't go into that. So definitely it implies different entry points, different exit points, and also you can engage in different subjects. And also you can develop school-based curriculum, and also you can engage in thematic approach in the connecting different kinds of values education subjects with live education. So you can see the diagram. This diagram shows first of all the Chinese cultural context. We have to consider the macro context as well as the education curriculum reform context. So you can see live education could be connected with moral and civic education, health education, education for sustainable development, religious or spirituality education, and life planning education. And also you can link under, because of the context of 21st century, you can link directly also embedding 21st century skills and components of 21st century education. So when it comes to the linkage between theory and practice, we have a framework proposed by Taiwan scholars and others. It's called Universe, People, Meta, and Self Framework. So this is involving different kinds of quotient, if you can name it, people, emotion, God quotient, self or intellect, intelligence quotient, knowledge quotient, and you can name others actually. It will help from a psychological and philosophical perspective achieve flourishing. In Hong Kong, the Hong Kong Holistic Life Education Association put forward body, mind, sociality and spirituality, and corresponding also with the aim to achieve flourishing in a balanced manner. Again, you can see a lot of examples connecting meta, human nature, interpersonality, and transcendence. So if you want to do life education, you want to do 21st century education and all together, I believe the stakeholders engagement is very important. Stakeholders involve teacher engagement, student engagement, parent engagement, and also community engagement. So to conclude the talk, because of time limitation, I'm going to go back how the life education, 21st century education connects the recent global trends. One of the global trends, of course, is the COVID, the impact of COVID. I think we are still under the impact of COVID during the time of this speech. I put forward in other occasions that we can use the acronym COVID to see how the new normal in education affect us. The new normal, I think the COVID will involve collaboration endeavors, understand complexity of the situation, but we have to be optimistic and try to make use of the online, like today I'm using online mode, with the allow variation and also virtual environment with vigor. We try to integrate different things, like where we integrate live education and 21st century education. We make use of different intelligence, different kind of quotients, a whole person development embed, and also we try to take advantage of digitization. We are members of the global world. So global citizenship is also important. Within the SEAMEO community, we have to support each other. I think it's also an important notion. So UNESCO also promote and OECD about what to teach, how to teach, and also how to assess, student assess performance. So it's not a local issue, but I believe a lot of things could be shared, could be discussed, and also be working together concertedly. So core competency, you can see that it involves attitude, values, skills, and knowledge. And also as a regional and international community like SEAMEO, we can consider different approaches. We can consider our issues, our positive experience, and also take actions if needed to help each other. So last is the connection and importance of integration. So you can see that I use a diagram to conclude this course. From life education, you can reconnect with different kinds of values education under different cultural contexts, under different communities. And we have a context of global and local and regional education reform context. We have also local context as well. And when we talk about education, I'm sure that we have to connect knowledge, values, and attitudes and skills. But we also have to consider broader framework like UNESCO. Now we talk about learning to become as well. And also other frameworks, SEAMEO have a lot of good framework for us to consider. So this is, I would like to share with you at this time point. This is a personal view again. And I hope that all of you will stay healthy. And we look forward to meeting other face-to-face in future. So this speech again, represent my personal view only and do not necessarily represent those of CRSE, EDU Hong Kong and UNESCO, and do not commit the respective organizations. Thank you.
MPA, the marine plastic abatement, we have several kind of that, the waste management, the plastic waste, the ecosystems, or the impacts of the ecosystem to the public health too. Yes, that cover a variety of the knowledge, including the business development model. There are 12 modules that we have in these modules. The very first one is kind of a fundamentals of the plastic waste management, and also characterizations together with that, how we can understand the effects or the impacts of the plastics, especially the microplastics or the nanoplastics in the marine ecosystems. That very important part. The second part would be about that, how we can manage, how we can use the technologies appropriately to tackle this kind of plastic pollutions. Then with this knowledge, we think that it is very important to get about how we develop the business or how we develop the interventions that appropriately to let the students, to let the graduates think about that. It is not only the sake of just a kind of thinking to use the technologies, but if we can get the profit out of the pollution, it is possible and should be more sustainable than just having a kind of that the thinking to be a good guys and then try to collect the plastic out of the ecosystem. No, we would like to think about that. In AAT, this is quite important too. Normally, we prefer to get, of course, in the face-to-face interaction with the students, but we try our best to use that the hybrid system that one student could use the kind of that in the classroom, and another group of students can use that the online, so that we can keep the social distancing together. But in the meantime, we cannot just get away out of this kind of interactive discussion, but we try to let them think about that, how we can use the group assignments or discussion even between the in-class or online students to work together. That's also very important to interact between the among the students. Our course also need a lot of that assignments and also the laboratory experimentations that the student need to get out to the field. So that, of course, it's quite difficult to get the student from the online to understand the subject from the on-class that they are doing. But we try to record, and then even having a kind of the on-demand to get the student interact with the ongoing student with the laboratory, for example. For example, we use that the microscope with connect with the Zoom, and then they can understand very well how they can recognize, how can they investigate the microplastics in the samples. Even they are not in the in the lab, but they are remotely check and count the, themselves the microplastics. That also possible that we can arrange. But also the laboratory, that also very important part that we try to use as much as possible the online that can train the students. But of course, the face-to-face training would be much better. We believe that if we can train the student and then let the student can work by themselves, not the virtually, they could be much better. But to this kind of the COVID-19 pandemic situations, we also need to adjust or adapt this kind of online learning practice for that purposes. That very important part that related to the future skill for the new career that they're going to do in the future. It is very important part that they should have had a kind of a transformative skills. For example, that we select the students not only the science or the social science or the engineering student only, but we have a variety of the background of the students so that they can learn from each other, that well, from the engineering school students to the science students, how can they work together, and then they can start understanding each other, that how they can adapt themselves to work in this kind of environment. Because in each individual modules, we have assignments, we have the group works, and then they have to discuss among themselves. For example, that we have the student from the having the business background, they will be much better in the sense that they can study the business module very, very well. But whereas the student from the science or from the social science, they may not have at all get a clue how to do with that. But once they discuss together, it's quite a nurture system that they can learn from each other. The student from who has the business background, they may not have a very good technological background. But once they discuss with the certain assignment, and then they can adjust themselves. So that I think that would be a very good point in our program that we can set on that. AIT try to develop this very unique program in a sense that it is more interdisciplinary approach, which we cover all science or kind of that social science or even up to the business development models, so that we have to have a very good group of the faculty member, I mean the instructors. Of course, AIT may not be able to do ourselves. We also invite the experts or the lecturers from the other universities to help us in the sense that we can get more expertise on that. So that would be the very good parts of this program that they can learn from many of the interdisciplinary experts, and also that they also need to do a kind of the research study. So within there is a study, it is a kind of the platform that they can do for themselves in the future. It's not necessary to be a kind of the research for the sake of research, but it could be the research for the sake of their development in the future, that they can develop their own business models because they're interested to convert the plastics to energy, and then they foresee that this would be the potential business for their life. That also fine. Or they're interested to investigate more the impacts of the plastics in the marine ecosystem because they interest on that. They work in the NGO, so they would like to do that, or the government sectors, so that this could help them to prepare themselves once they get back into the careers, so they can propose themselves that this is a new knowledge, this is a new findings that they can use for their own careers. Kind of that the emerging issue, because the plastics is everywhere, and we never ever understand the impacts of them for decades, right? Recently we found out that all human beings discharge the plastic into the environment, and then at the end it's come down to the marine ecosystems or to the oceans, which is very sadly many animals, many fish, many livings have been dead because of the plastics. but that the macroplastics. But we haven't heard of that the impacts of the microplastic yet. It is start growing, and then it is becoming more and more serious because we discharge very, very high amount of the plastics, more than 200,000 tons, million tons a year that we discharge into the environment. But how we can manage properly? But if we just think about bad manage, how we can manage in a more efficiently, in a more way that it would be more sustained, and then the people can understand this kind of subject very importantly. So this would be the very important part because it impacts every human being, not only the wildlife or the ocean ecosystem, even from that the people who stay in a landlocked country, they are still eating salt. And we found out that salt having microplastics. So they have to import the salt from ocean anyway. So if even they say that, well, they have no impacts with that the plastic pollution because they are landlocked country, but no, they're still there. The seafood, the salt, and many others come with the microplastics, that very important parts. So this is a very important part that the general support by the Japanese government, it is very, very fundamental to develop this program because they have the vision that in the year 2030, they should eradicate all these kind of plastic pollutions. And one of the key issues or the key matters that we can get to that is not that only develop the technologies or innovation, but we need more human resources. We need to empower the people who gain more knowledge and how to manage, how to use wisely the technologies or management practices. So this is a very important part. That's why AIT, the Asian Institute of Technologies, would like to get this more and more people, not only in the region like Southeast Asia, but widely from the South Asia, from Africa, from Latin America, from other regions, to study and then make use of our knowledge widely to the global problems. So that would be the one. And interestingly, that this program we developed in a sense that we try to create new values from the West, right? So this is another thing that very fundamental for the future skill of the new generation that they need to have, because you cannot just say that you have nothing, you just study from the textbook and then you have no other values. But this kind of program, the modules, we try to create the new values to the students that, hey, you understand the new subjects and then you know variety of the disciplines, like from engineer, from science to social science to the business part. Then you can have your own new values. So that would be another future skill set that we can try to offer from this program. Many scholarships remains. I think it's about that 30, 40 scholarships available, the full scholarships from the Japanese government, and then they can send the applications to AIT that we can consider that based on your background, based on your interest, and then we can recruit you to join this program.
Thank you very much. I'm sure most of our online participants are very eager to learn more about the offerings. The last one, which is a scholarship slot.
Yeah, that's right. And the scholarship provides free tuition fee and also free accommodation, free living costs in Thailand. But the student who want to apply for this must contact the focal person of AIT, which we will pin the email address of the focal person in the chat box of the YouTube.
So the senior secretariat team has been posting the links and the email addresses of the focal person for you to touch base with and know more about the offerings that are featured in their presentations. Okay, so at this point, we'd like to recognize the more than almost 900 participants joining us live and more than 2,400 joining us on playback.
So many
are learning with us. So Let's now go to the next chapter, and this one will talk about the future skills for workforce. So we have two presenters. The first one is Ms. Sarah Marshall from Beth Asia, from Malaysia, and she will be talking about enhancing future skills for students and IR 4.0. Mm-hmm. And another one is from Equitable Education Fund, and they will be presenting about future skills for students and IR 4.0 solutions in Thailand.
Yes, that's great. Okay, let's see the presentation.
Okay.
Thank you for inviting Bet here today to talk about enhancing future skills for students and teaching for the fourth industrial revolution. A little bit about us. At Bet, we believe in creating a better future by transforming education. Our mission is to bring together people, learners, ideas, practices, and technologies so that educators and learners can fulfill their potential. We run a number of shows all around the world, and Bet Asia is one of our highlights. Bet Asia is the APAC region's leading education technology conference and expo. We gather senior leaders from K-12, higher and further education, solutions providers, ministries of education, and policymakers. Bet Asia showcases the latest ideas, achievements, thought leadership, and solutions to drive future-ready education for all within the APAC region. In November 2020, Bet convened a powerful group of education leaders in Southeast Asia. Attendees came from the Asian Development Bank, SEAMEO, the Ministries of Education in Indonesia, the Philippines, and Thailand, and representation from HP and Microsoft. Discussions focused on the impact of COVID-19 on long-term education priorities and four long-term priorities for education and work in Southeast Asia were identified. The first priority is to blend both old and new technologies to ensure universal access to education. In the past year, a multimodal approach to learning delivery has been instrumental in providing equitable education for the greatest number of students possible during the pandemic. These initiatives must be continued and expanded to achieve universal access to education. The second priority is that teachers and parents are both an integral part of the solution. The crisis has instigated a remodeling of the instructional core of learning, largely driven by the increased presence and evolved role of teachers and parents. Education policymakers and tech companies must develop this further through upskilling, training, and supporting parents as well as teachers to secure the success of innovations in teaching and learning. Priority three, the success of the current and future workforce requires a culture of lifelong learning. Although Southeast Asia has long prioritized the skills gap and focusing on a 21st century workforce, COVID-19 has made this more difficult. Increasing unemployment and accelerating automation has led to an unprecedented spike in unemployment and a real urgency to reskill and upskill future as well as current workers. Priority four, increased and strategic investment in partnerships is essential to drive education. New and existing partnerships at a school, industry, community and government level should be strategically harnessed beyond the current crisis to actualize education as a key enabler for socio-economic development. We're going to look more closely at future-proofing the workforce and a vision for lifelong learning. Our educational systems are tasked with preparing young people for a job market with an almost universal demand for technology skills. To thrive rather than survive in the fourth industrial revolution, we must teach what we cannot automate and empower our workforce to become first-class humans and not second-class robots. Research from Intel, presented at our Best Fest show in January 2021, noted that there must be an increased emphasis on creativity and higher order thinking skills to foster innovation and differentiate humans from machines. SEAMEO centers are already training teachers on developing these 21st century skills. They've gone further than the Intel suggestions, and they focus on not just ICT-based competencies, but a global look at what's going on: sustainable development, global citizenship, human rights, peace, justice, and driving the sustainable development goals. Closer partnerships with business can support classroom learning and help connect students with tangible futures. In the UK, the Rolls-Royce Digital Academy offers free training courses mapped to the national curriculum to help build skills for future jobs. And HP have created HP Life, a global training program on and offline that provides free access to 32 courses to help students and workers build relevant skills from entrepreneurship to design thinking to small business management and leadership. So far, over 340,000 students in more than 200 countries have been enrolled on this free program. So let's talk about reskilling and upskilling the current workforce. Deloitte's 2020 Global Human Capital Trends report indicates that reskilling is the highest priority for Asia compared to other trends. And the World Economic Forum Future of Jobs report 2020 identified increased changes in job demands due to the increase in work in remote working and learning. However, learning and development for workers has been deprioritized as part of business continuation and recovery. But supporting businesses to invest in their people is vital. Tax incentives or facilitating partnerships with education institutions could encourage companies to prioritize worker skills. Micro-credentials and nano-degrees that can be worked around a full-time job could support the workforce to reskill. We think that the future will demand a range of skills, including the following: analytical thinking and innovation, active learning and learning strategies, creativity, originality and initiative, technology design and programming, critical thinking and analysis, complex problem solving, leadership and social influence, emotional intelligence, reasoning, problem solving and ideation, and systems analysis and evaluation. But we can't work in isolation to achieve these skills for our workforce and our young people. Partnership between government, educators, parents, and business focused on collective goals is key. And working together, it is possible to realize the potential of the fourth industrial revolution and ensure a resilient and dynamic socioeconomic future for Southeast Asia. And here at BET, we're ready to help. We have free support available for educators everywhere. If you visit our website, betshow.com. Our community hub has articles and resources for provided by other educators. We offer regular webinars through our BETcast. We have monthly accredited CPD through our BET Academy. And last month, we ran a 3-day program of training and inspiration for educators everywhere, which you can review at BETfest. That's betshow.com/BETfest. If you would like to find out more about our research, we'd be very happy to send you a copy. And if you'd like to find out more about our BET Show or the BET portfolio in general, then please contact Jackie Danowski. Her details are on the screen here. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present to you today, and I hope you have found this of value.
Good morning. Welcome to today's presentation, Future Skill for Student and Industry Revolution 4.0 Solutions, My name is Santita Wong Prasong from the Equitable Education Fund, EEF. This session, we will particularly look at how to prepare students who are in vocational education to succeed industry and Thailand 4.0. First, I would like to invite Dr. Supachai C. Sushat, Dean of Faculty of Economics, Thammasat University, to give you an overview of situations and skills for youth to succeed in preparing for industry in Thailand 4.0. Dr. Supachai, please, the floor is yours.
ครับผมผู้ช่วยศาสตราจารย์ดร. สุภชัย ศรีสุชาตินะครับคณบดีคณะเศรษฐศาสตร์มหาวิทยาลัยธรรมศาสตร์นะครับสำหรับแนวคิดของการพัฒนาคนในระดับอาชีวศึกษาเนี่ยนะครับเป็นหนึ่งในการที่จะพัฒนาระบบเศรษฐกิจของประเทศเพื่อให้หลุดพ้นจากกับดักรายได้ปานกลางนะครับโดยการหลุดพ้นทางเศรษฐกิจนี้เนี่ยประเทศไทยเองเนี่ยยังมีปัจจัยต่างๆที่เป็นความท้าทายโดยเป็นความท้าทายในเชิงโครงสร้างมาโดยตลอดทั้งในเรื่องของโครงสร้างอายุประชากรนะครับที่เราจะมีผู้สูงวัยมากขึ้นกำลังแรงงานน้อยลงนะครับในเรื่องของความเหลื่อมล้ำนะครับทางรายได้ระหว่างคนแต่ละกลุ่มรวมถึงคนผู้ด้อยโอกาสนะครับที่อาจจะอยู่ชายขอบหรือว่าคนที่ไม่สามารถเข้าสู่ศูนย์กลางทางเศรษฐกิจได้นะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเนี่ยโจทย์หรือประเด็นเหล่านี้เนี่ยคงต้องนำมาคิดในการพัฒนากำลังคนโดยเฉพาะกำลังคนของอาชีวศึกษานะครับอีกเรื่องนึงก็คือการที่จะเข้าไปตอบโจทย์ของตลาดแรงงานนะครับที่คนที่จะต้องได้รับการฝึกฝีมือฝึกอาชีพนะครับมีความสามารถตรงความต้องการของนายจ้างนะครับแล้วก็มีทักษะที่จำเป็นต่อการเป็นผู้ประกอบการหรือว่าการเป็นลูกจ้างที่มีคุณภาพสูงในระบบเศรษฐกิจนะครับดังนั้นเนี่ยประเทศไทยเนี่ยก็ได้มีนโยบายที่จะผลักดันในเรื่องพวกนี้นโยบายที่สำคัญหลักตอนนี้ก็คือเรื่องของยุทธศาสตร์ประเทศ20ปีนะครับที่มีการวางทรัพยากรนะครับมีการพูดถึงการจัดสรรทรัพยากรใหม่เพื่อให้เกิดเศรษฐกิจใหม่ที่มีมูลค่าสูงนะครับเศรษฐกิจที่มีมูลค่าสูงเหล่านั้นเองเนี่ยนะมีความจำเป็นที่ต้องการกำลังแรงงานกำลังคนที่มีสติปัญญามีความรู้ความสามารถในระดับที่สูงขึ้นนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเองเนี่ยแนวคิดในการพัฒนาคุณภาพของกำลังคนเนี่ยจึงเป็นเรื่องสำคัญนะครับทีนี้พอมาพูดถึงเรื่องกำลังคนเนี่ยนะครับเราก็อาจจะแบ่งคนออกเป็นสายสามัญกับสายอาชีวะนะครับสายสามัญก็อาจจะไปคิดในเชิงทฤษฎีไปทำงานที่อยู่ในระบบนะครับในการที่จะผลักดันนโยบายผลักดันมาตรการอะไรต่างๆแต่ในกำลังคนอีกกลุ่มหนึ่งที่สำคัญที่เราพูดถึงกันก็คือกำลังคนในกลุ่มอาชีวศึกษานะครับที่มีหลายรูปแบบนะครับที่จะเป็นตัวจักรจริงๆในระบบเศรษฐกิจแต่สัดส่วนของจำนวนของบุคลากรในสายอาชีวะเนี่ยอาจจะยังน้อยอยู่นะเพราะค่านิยมบางอย่างที่คนไทยเห็นนะครับแล้วก็ค่าตอบแทนด้วยนะครับที่ทำให้คนของเราเนี่ยไหลไปอยู่ในระบบสายสามัญเยอะนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเนี่ยมาตรการหรือกลไกของภาครัฐในการที่จะส่งเสริมให้เกิดการทำงานนะหรือว่าการเรียนในระบบสายอาชีวะจึงมีความสำคัญนะครับในปัจจุบันเนี่ยเรามีสถานอาชีวะของรัฐเนี่ยอยู่สักประมาณ429แห่งนะครับแล้วก็ของภาคเอกชนอีก445แห่งนะฮะรวมสักประมาณ874แห่งนะครับใน400กว่าแห่งที่เป็นของรัฐเนี่ยนะครับก็จะแบ่งสาขาวิชานะครับหรือเรียกว่าเป็นวิทยาลัยที่แตกต่างกันมีความหลากหลายอยู่พอสมควรสักประมาณ17ประเภทนะครับซึ่งทั้งหมดเนี่ยนะครับก็พยายามที่จะสร้างบัณฑิตอาชีวะออกมานะครับโดยสถานการณ์ปัจจุบันเนี่ยเรามีนักศึกษานะครับของอาชีวะเนี่ยที่อยู่ในระบบเนี่ยสักประมาณ1ล้านคนนะครับอาจจะเทียบแล้วเนี่ยไม่ได้เยอะนะครับเมื่อเทียบกับสายสามัญ นะครับที่มีจำนวนเนี่ยนะฮะถ้าในระดับปวช.เองเนี่ยนะครับอาชีวะมีอยู่สัก 600,000 กว่าแต่สายสามัญเนี่ยมีอยู่ประมาณล้านกว่านะครับสัดส่วนก็สักประมาณ65-35แต่เป้าของประเทศนะครับอยากให้สายอาชีวะเนี่ยนะครับขยับขึ้นเป็น 50-50 ให้ได้นะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเนี่ยก็ต้องมีแรงจูงใจหรือมีการสร้างนวัตกรรมอะไรบางอย่างเพื่อจูงใจให้คนเข้ามาเรียนในระบบอาชีวะนะครับการสร้างแรงจูงใจเบื้องต้นเนี่ยนะครับก็คือการพัฒนาคุณภาพนะครับสำหรับนักศึกษาชี้ให้เขาเห็นนะครับว่าเป้าหมายในชีวิตของการจบอาชีวะเนี่ยเขามีคุณค่าต่อการเป็นบุคลากรที่สำคัญของประเทศยังไงนะครับค่าตอบแทนนะครับต้องมีความเหมาะสมนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเองเนี่ยนะครับทางกสศเองก็มีนวัตกรรมหลายๆอย่างนะครับที่มาสนับสนุนการเรียนรู้ของภาคอาชีวะนะครับ แต่ว่าก่อนถึงนวัตกรรมตัวนั้นเนี่ยนะครับคงต้องมองนโยบายในภาพใหญ่เหมือนกันว่านโยบายในภาพใหญ่ของระดับประเทศในการที่จะส่งเสริมอาชีวศึกษาตัวนี้เนี่ยมีอะไรนะครับตัวอย่างเช่นการพัฒนาเทคนิคการเรียนการสอนนะครับการสร้างหลักสูตรเพื่อตอบโจทย์หรือการสร้างทักษะเพื่ออนาคตนะครับการส่งเสริมให้เอกชนเนี่ยเข้ามามีส่วนร่วมในการที่จะจัดการหลักสูตรการสร้างระบบกิจการสตาร์ทอัพนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นเนี่ยนักศึกษาเองก็จะต้องมีทักษะของการเรียนรู้การเป็นผู้ประกอบการนะครับแล้วก็มีฐานแล้วก็ใช้ทรัพยากรในพื้นที่ให้เกิดประโยชน์สูงสุดสามารถที่จะนำองค์ความรู้เหล่านั้นเนี่ยไปพัฒนาพื้นที่ได้นะครับทีนี้เนี่ยนอกเหนือจากที่เป็นเรื่องของทักษะที่เป็นทักษะหลักแล้วเนี่ยยังมีทักษะที่เป็นทักษะเสริมบางคนใช้คำว่าเป็น soft skill future soft skill ในอนาคตเนี่ยนะครับทักษะเสริมที่จำเป็นของอาชีวะในปี2020เนี่ยนะครับเขาแรงไว้สักประมาณ10อันดับนะครับตัวแรกที่จำเป็นก็คือเรื่องของการมี complex problem solving ก็คือเรื่องของความคิดในการที่จะแก้ไขปัญหาที่มีความสลับซับซ้อนเพิ่มมากขึ้นนะครับcritical thinking หรือการคิดเชิงวิเคราะห์การคิดในสถานการณ์ที่สำคัญเนี่ยนะครับในสถานการณ์วิกฤตเนี่ยสามารถที่จะมีกลไกในการคิดในการแก้ปัญหาได้นะครับเรื่องของ creative นะครับก็คือเรื่องของความคิดสร้างสรรค์นะครับเป็นทักษะที่3นะทักษะที่4เป็นทักษะในเรื่องการบริหารจัดการคนนะเราเรียกว่าเป็น people management นะครับทักษะที่5เป็นเรื่องของความสามารถในการที่จะทำงานร่วมกับคนอื่นนะครับเป็น coordinating นะครับว่าสามารถทำงานร่วมกับทีมได้นะครับทักษะที่6เองเป็นทักษะที่เพิ่มเข้ามาใหม่นะครับหลุดเข้ามาสำหรับการจัดเรียงทักษะที่จำเป็นก็คือ emotional intelligence ก็คือความฉลาดรู้ทางอารมณ์นะครับตัวที่7เป็นเรื่องของความสามารถในการที่จะตัดสินใจนะครับการเลือกต่างๆ decision making แล้วก็ตัดสินใจอย่างถูกต้องนะครับทักษะที่8เป็นเรื่องของ service orientation นะครับว่าสถานประกอบการก็คงอยากได้คนที่มีจิตใจที่รักบริการแม้ว่างานอาจจะไม่ใช่งานบริการแต่อย่างน้อยเนี่ยคิดว่าทักษะในการที่จะให้บริการผู้อื่นให้บริการผู้ร่วมงานเนี่ยต้องมีนะครับตัวที่9คือการเจรจาต่อรองแล้วก็ตัวที่10ก็คือความสามารถในการปรับเปลี่ยนนะครับความสามารถในการยืดหยุ่นตัวเองได้นะเพราะฉะนั้น10ทักษะเนี่ยเป็น10ทักษะในฟิวเจอร์ที่เป็นเรื่องของซอฟต์สกิลนะครับด้วยข้อจำกัดของจำนวนนักศึกษาอาชีวะที่ยังมีอยู่น้อยนะครับสาขายังมีความหลากหลายอยู่นะครับสำหรับอาชีวะซึ่งทางกสศเองเนี่ยก็มีนวัตกรรมทางการเรียนรู้นะครับบวกกับนวัตกรรมที่เป็นการให้ทุนนะฮะสำหรับผู้เรียนในระดับอาชีวะศึกษาเพื่อจูงใจให้เด็กเก่งเด็กที่มีความสามารถนะครับคนที่อยากเป็นคนอาชีวะจริงๆเนี่ยเข้ามาสู่ระบบการศึกษาแล้วก็มีระบบฟูมฟักสามารถที่จะสร้างให้เขาได้เรียนรู้ได้มีคุณธรรมจริยธรรมตามวัตถุประสงค์ที่เราต้องการนะครับสำหรับประเทศไทยเป็นหนึ่งในประเทศที่มีความเหลื่อมล้ำอยู่ในระดับที่สูงอยู่นะครับในแง่ของรายได้ระหว่างคนรวยกับคนจนทีนี้เนี่ยช่องทางหรือแนวมาตรการที่ใช้ในการตัดวงจรของความเหลื่อมล้ำเนี่ยก็คือระบบการศึกษาระบบการศึกษาที่สามารถเปิดโอกาสให้กับคนที่มีรายได้น้อยคนที่อาจจะขาดโอกาสเนี่ยเข้าสู่ระบบการศึกษาได้นะครับซึ่งการเรียนอาชีวศึกษาเนี่ยก็เป็นหนึ่งในบทพิสูจน์นะครับว่าสามารถที่ทำให้คนเนี่ยสามารถเข้าสู่ระบบการศึกษาได้นะครับแล้วก็อาจจะตรงกับความสามารถของตัวเองอย่างที่บอกตั้งแต่ตอนเริ่มต้นนะครับว่าระบบอาชีวะจะเป็นระบบหนึ่งนะครับที่ทำให้เศรษฐกิจของประเทศไทยเนี่ยเติบโตได้แล้วก็ช่วยลดในเรื่องของความเหลื่อมล้ำระหว่างกลุ่มนะครับและท้ายสุดเองเนี่ยทำให้เศรษฐกิจมีความยั่งยืนนะครับแล้วก็สามารถที่จะคงอยู่ได้ในระยะยาวขอบคุณครับ
Thank you Dr. Supachai I would like to present you another case of vocational education In Thailand we have problems similar to many countries but on a different scale I can only highlight some of them We have a low higher education enrollment of students from very low income families within the lowest 20%Another key issue of Thailand education is mismatch of school leavers and labor force demand. We need a higher proportion of vocational education graduates, like in other countries, due to its bad image and the value of parents and society as a whole. Parents are often reluctant to send their kids to vocational school, but want them to go to university. For some students, the university may not, however, be best choice to be successful. In order to solve these problems, we need to reconsider vocational education system. Can we provide a better access to students from very low income families? Can we redesign education system that will motivate students to study more and prepare them to enter the labor force market for more successfully? One initiative that has been developed by the EEF is called Vocational Innovation Scholarship and Colleges Grants. This program is two-pronged approach, aiming not only to provide higher education access to target students, but also to develop teaching and learning model with vocational colleges. Model that we are looking for are quality career guidance services in the school, student well-being support, development of skills that meet the needs of labor force for the development of Thailand 4.0 economy, apprenticeship and engagement of business, life skill and job placement. I will not go into details, but I recommend you to visit the EEF website. Last but not least, what next for Thailand? As you can see, we still have a lot to learn. We need to evaluate the existing program, and there's a need to build awareness of the system among policymakers and make it more relevant, so that we need to engage with more major industries. In short, I think there are two key issues that we all need to consider. First, does this system adequately address the equity problem? Second, that is provide the skilled workforce that we all need. So thank you.
Okay, so to those who are interested to have playback or to know more about the offering, they can check the recording of all these lectures. We'll be uploading them on our website.
Right. There are many requests from the participants. How can they take how can download the video?
Yes,
you know, and also some of them asking that how can they get the opportunity from the partner again?
Yes,
so you can go back to review again. And thank you so much for the participation of the nearly 890 participants at the moment in live, and also 4,000 participants on watching playback.
So maybe they're reviewing the offerings or capturing or copying the email addresses.
That's right.
For the scholarship slots that they're interested to take part of, because we have shared so many scholarship slots, from our partners.
Right. And there are more presentation from the partners, and then with more offering, right, in different ways. And for this chapter, it's about IR 4.0 skills and knowledge. Mm-hmm. And we have three presenters, which will present the practical ideas for high school, TVET, and university students and teachers to understand the implication of the IR 4.0 in the classroom. And we have two presenters from UK. One person, Mr. Jonathan Ledger from the Department of International Trade UK. And the next person from the side group, Ms. Laura Brown. And the last person, Ms. Janice from Wedong Crowd Education Group, PR China. So I think that it's very important to learn from them for our Southeast Asian teachers and educators.
Okay.
Hi everybody, Jonathan Ledger here, Global TVET Specialist for the Department for International Trade in London, UK. I want to talk to you today about Industry 4 in the world of technical and vocational education and training. And I guess COVID, you know, presents some really interesting challenges in the way that we deal with vocational training remotely, blended learning, and make use of that technology to really deliver the range of skills that are required across the world. The way that we gather our skills is changing rapidly, and we need to make sure that we keep up with that. There's a lot of dynamic innovation that's going on at the moment, and training providers all across the globe are making use of all the technologies. So whether that's virtual reality, or whether it's augmented reality, or whether it's robotics, it's all coming to play in the world of TVET. And you've got to try and remember that when we're dealing with technical and vocational training, we want to build people's skills and competence, and somehow we have to be able to test that remotely using different techniques, because we can't necessarily stand next to those individuals. And of course, the world that we live in is all interconnected. All of these skill areas, all of these industry four key enabling technologies are all plugged into one another, and they create a really diverse skills landscape in terms of the way that these technologies are deployed in our learning scenarios. You can imagine how different skill areas are required, say, in an office environment as compared to a factory, as compared to an engineering workshop. You know, you need to make sure that those RFIDs, or whether you're using 3D printing, you know, all of these technologies have somehow got to be practiced and taught over the internet and using technology. We do see EdTech as an enabler. We do see that, you know, there are benefits to be had from using education technology and industry for training over the internet, in terms of the way that teachers reduce their workload and manage their workload, but also for companies in terms of the cost of training and education, and for learners it's about accessibility. But we still must make sure in the accessibility point that we still get learners that are skilled and qualified at the end of the exercise. The UK is at the forefront of innovation when it comes to implementing and designing and developing Industry 4 skills using technology and in the world of vocational education. We have a range of providers of all shapes and sizes using all sorts of technologies that are able to support the achievement of skilled outcomes. And we focus really at the front end of that on what employers need for the jobs that they have available. UK supplier MKDL uses advanced technology to create learning solutions for technical and vocational training and education. Their mission is to shape the future of learning so that no learner gets left behind. Their approach is all about consortium, bringing in the right experts and specialisms to make sure they can create the skills and deliver the skills that are required. They have a range of partners from colleges to universities to training providers. The aim of their programs is to provide underpinning knowledge and skills in subjects, and to be able to carry out those specific tasks and scenarios and reinforce that best practice and safety in a really quick and efficient way. The detail of each program is taken from real life scenarios, including the sound and the specific sensory experiences. The scenarios can be based on delivering skills, knowledge, or assessment, depending on the objectives for that particular learning program. MKDL current products include a nursing program developed in line with level 3 qualifications and is supported by many national and international healthcare organizations. MKDL really listened to training providers and to students and to employers to make sure that the learning materials that they've developed are both innovative and interactive, because what they need to be able to create is that technical expertise that goes with a really kind of high responsibility job. And of course, built into the software and the learning materials are lots of quizzes to continually check that knowledge of the learning of the student to make sure it's going in and to give them their results, which is just fantastic. Their electrical engineering program is also developed in line with level 3 qualifications and is supported by many colleges and institutions. It includes augmented reality and scenarios around diagnostics and repair. All that is needed is a device. No headsets are necessary, so avoiding the extra cost and inaccessibility headsets would require. In this scenario, learners need to get 100% correct before they can progress. There is an assessment outcome at the end of each block of learning. Their products lead to an abundance of positive outcomes for educators, learners and industry. For example, for educators, there's a reduction in the cost of learning materials and consumables and overcoming classroom restrictions. Learners benefit by improving their understanding of complex subjects, boosting confidence and engagement by doing and improving knowledge and skill retention through practice. And for industry and employers, the scalability of learning standards and the reduction in delivery costs and engaging with remote, hard-to-reach learners, both geographically and economically, resulting in more talent than ever before. This is your chance to free access to online training all about Industry 4. It's available 24/7 from any device. There are loads of modules to choose from, and they include 3D printing, augmented reality, robotics, cybersecurity, standards and legal issues, simulation and modeling, Internet of Things, big data and analytics. So get there. The only thing missing is you. If you're into Industry 4 with key enabling technologies, then get into this free learning material. It's online 24/7, 365. Go to app.infoword.eu now and register for your free Industry 4 program. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Laura, and I'm here today to represent NIFI Group. We have been delivering quality education using our online platform for the last 25 years to students in both the UK and around the world. Industrial Revolution 4.0 is therefore very important to us and the way in which we can ensure that students are prepared for the future. Formal education was introduced in the 19th century to help to meet the needs of industry. This is reflected within the hierarchy of subjects which are shown within a traditional school, with focus being placed on languages, mathematics, and the sciences. But if we're on Industry 4.0, then we should also be on Education 4.0 by now, but nothing much has changed. We're responsible for preparing students for their future, but we don't know what that future will look like. The speed of development at the moment is alarming, and we cannot see that far ahead. It's therefore important that we prepare students with the skills that they're going to need to be able to continue to learn, to grow and develop, rather than purely academic knowledge. we can already see how the fourth industrial revolution has changed our world. So from self-scanning your shopping to virtual doctors and the continued growth of online shopping. This reliance on technology should be reflected within education. Whereas previously it was important for students to be able to use an index in a textbook, it's now important that they can use the tools of a search engine effectively. We have to change and adapt to the needs of the students to develop lifelong learners. And if learning has changed, then why hasn't teaching? The use of the internet is the single biggest change that education has faced in recent years. But this isn't enough. We need to look at the curriculum, the styles of assessment, the ways in which we share that education with others. That's all just a starting point for the development. Online learning has become more widely accepted due to the reliance on this during enforced lockdowns due to COVID-19. And some people have now started to recognize the benefits of this, but we need to keep it going. We're able to provide more than just lectures or pre-recorded tutorials. Students aren't just handed a worksheet and told to get on with it alone. Trained and qualified teachers are able to offer the same support as they would do in a traditional classroom. Students can find that there are fewer restrictions to their learning. They can join in from anywhere. They can take advantage of the expertise that isn't always available in your immediate location. They can use skills which can help them to progress within their studies or at work, including the continued use of ICT in all activities. We need to think about future-proofing. How can we make sure that students have the skills that they need? They have to adapt to whatever the future is going to hold for them. We can do this by not only focusing on those academic subjects as is traditionally set out, but also think about the use of language, mathematics, and ICT within every area. Making sure that they have the opportunity to develop real life experiences, which will help them within the workplace. Make sure that they have the opportunity to discover different cultures, which they can then go on to compare to their own and could be beneficial for them for future communications in our multicultural society. And making sure that they can complete work holistically using cross-curricular planning. Need to consider the use of the four C's and the rewarding of soft skills within development. So the four C's of communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and creativity should be supported to help with the overall development of the student. We need to ensure that we build the confidence of the young person. At a younger age, we're willing to take a risk. But as we get older, we become scared of failure. We need to encourage students to investigate new ideas, to take risks throughout their education. It's that willingness to try something new that will help them in the future. That's how they will find the new discoveries that will take us there. Teamwork, communication skills, turn-taking, and so on, they're all key skills which we expect an employee to have, but we don't spend time teaching those areas. Education has to adapt to ensure that our students have all of the skills that they need to go forward and that they can feel proud of their achievements. We recognize the journey that the individual student goes on, not just in comparison to their peers. Success will look different for each person. A focus on contextualized learning can also support students in investigating how their education will affect their real lives. By seeing how a holistic approach to learning, for example, can allow learning aims from multiple traditional subjects to be met at the same time, or by thinking about ways in which we can use the internet to engage with others around the world to consider comparisons in multiple countries. They can see how that will then be important for them and engage further with it. Until education has had its revolution, we need to tread a careful line. So students still have to be taught what is traditionally expected to be able to gain their qualifications that are recognised within society. But we can currently consider the way in which this can happen and the way in which online learning can begin to take down some of those barriers. We're hoping to make an impact on the development of the whole child, not just their brain, but also their morals, their ideals, and their actions. They'll be able to consider their role as a global citizen. They will be the leaders of the future. They will be kind and caring towards others. We have a number of programs already running, which you may be interested in hearing about, including programs linked to the Sustainable Development Goals, leadership and training courses for adults, just to name a few. If you'd like to get in touch to discuss your needs and what we can offer, then please use the details on the screen now. We also have two programs which are available to you for free. And again, if you would like to find out more information, you have the link at the bottom of the screen there and the QR code. Thank you.
Hi everyone, this is Emily from Weidong International Cloud Education Industrial Park. Before we proceed to the digital educational solutions, I will give you a brief introduction of our park. As you may see from the camera, it is huge with 1,200 acres. It can also accommodate more than 5,000 people live, work, and study. The park serves for multiple purposes, but all related to education. For example, our headquarters located here, of course. The virtual reality R&D center is also here. So you can see from my left side, there are several universities, high-end college, and also business incubator behind. On my left side, this is our Technology Exploration Center. Here we exhibit our solutions, products, and showcase, and that's where we will walk through later. Behind our Technology Exhibition Center, we have our own data center with 5,000 servers, and which provide the powerful hosting service for Weidong educational applications and platforms all around China. So let's follow me. We will enter to our Technology Exploration Center. We will begin our trip from here. I have my colleague Olivia, who is waiting for you in the smart classroom. So please enjoy trip. And Olivia, the screen is yours.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I am Olivia. Welcome to Weidong Smart Classroom. As we all know, smart classroom is a very typical example of ICT technology in education. And the smart classroom is very popular for schools and universities all over the world. For Weidong, we provide a comprehensive solution for smart classroom. And the most important component of smart classroom is VLMS. Look, VLMS is a learning management system which can support multiple educational models, such as self-adaptive learning, autonomous learning, distance education, live streaming classes, and flipped classes. It can be used for K-12 education, TVET, and also higher education. To fully explore the potential of smart classroom, we will also equip your classroom with hardware. For example, tablets, smartphones. Of course, we will also recommend laptop computers and desktop computers to install in your classroom. We know that smart classroom welcomes all new technologies. We have recently developed a new product. The name is Look, L-O-O-K. Just have a look. My colleague is writing something on a special notebook, and all her handwriting has been synchronized on the smartphone. It is a little magic, right? So this is our AI technology, and the first thing which Look can do for teachers. Now, let's look at the second thing. It's a magical tool in my hand. Please now look at the screen. I will show you something. Hello. My friends. Nice to meet you. As we can see, all my speeches have been synchronized on the screen. This is also AI technology. And with this function, teachers can record all her classes. Okay, so much for smart classroom. And now let's move to We Are Classroom. Follow my steps. This is our We Are Classroom. And the We Are Classroom is primarily made up of 3D projector, We Are Big Screen, We Are Glasses, which my colleague is now wearing, and controls in her hands. Now please look at the screen. What is this? Actually, it is an illustration of the structure of human eyes. We Are resources is quite essential for We Are classroom. We don't have developed abundant We Are resources for us, waiting for you to come. Just have a try. We Are classroom is only the beginning of today's We Are trip. And now, let's move to our We Are Vocational Training Center. Follow my steps. Hello, my dear friend. What are you doing? My dear audience, you can see that now my colleague is using the We Are equipment to practice. And on the screen, actually, it is a helicopter, and she is now learning helicopter-related knowledge and skills. So this station is our VR station for the training of helicopter. Okay, now let's move to the second station. Hello, ladies. How are you? What are you doing? Plans. Okay, I guess they are trying to design their own plans and make their plan fly. So this is our aircraft VR system, which allows users to design their own plans and try flying their plans. So this system is quite suitable for science museums. Alright, the third station, follow me. Look, what is he doing? He is wearing the set of VR settings. He is wearing VR equipment. Oh, I think he is trying to repair something. Actually, where we are standing now, this is We Are Training Center for industrial equipment and also public transportation vehicles. And my colleague now is trying its single mode. And let's move and say here. This is multi multiplayer collaboration mode. And with this term, we allow the users to work together to fix something, to repair something. Okay, so much for this station. And next. Oh my god. Handsome. Shooting. He is trying to shoot some bad guys. So, this is the... emergency response system. And shooting bad guys is impossible. It's only one of our unique scenarios. We also provide abundant VR resources to understand. We also provide abundant user scenarios such as floods, storms, earthquakes, and fire emergencies. Okay, so much for this. And now let's move to a more exciting station. Follow my steps. Hello, Peter. How are you? Wow. My colleague Peter is driving. I think he's driving very well now. This is our driving simulation system, and this is concise version. Look, he's doing well. With this system, we allow the potential users, I mean the potential drivers, to be qualified driver to acquire knowledge and practice their driving skills. Wonderful, right? Now, let me show you something very, very funny and big. Look, what's this? A bus. Actually, it is a bus shell. And we always install the driving simulation system into this bus shell to bring better user experiences to our clients. So, welcome to Weido to hear my experience of it. The station is waiting for us. Let's go. Yes, here. Guess what's inside? Inside is our virtual airport management system. You want to have a look at it? Sure. Wow, what is happening? Oh my god, it's storming, it's raining at the airport. So, the system allows us to imitate what is really happening at the airport and then train the airport staff to learn how to coordinate, to manage the taking off and landing of different planes. Oh, by the way, do you know the Singapore Changi Airport? They are using this system to train their airport staff now, and they told us this system works pretty well and helps a lot. Okay, now I'm afraid I have to say this is the end of today's VR trip. And I believe, my dear audience, you must already have an understanding of what Weidong can do. Weidong is committed to establish an innovative education ecosystem to improve the ability of teaching, learning, and training to make a better world. Okay, my dear audience, thank you for your time and attention, and hope to see you here in Qingdao and in China. Welcome. Thank you.
Wow, that's very interesting video from our partners from UK and from the China.
I think we generated a lot of interest on our YouTube page and talking about how amazing that the presentation of Weidong and including the previous presentations as
well. Yes, that's right. Amazing technology as well that are using for training their own students. Yeah.
I think Weidong has indicated there how to contact them. So I'm sure it has generated a number of interested participants. Please feel free to get in touch with them so that you will learn more about how is it possible for you to have something if not really like that close to that.
Yes, so but they can apply. The teacher, the Southeast mm-hmm. Asian teachers can apply from the technology that provided mm-hmm. by Wedong, you know, and then adapt for our students, right?
Okay, so let's now move on to our last part of this lecture. Mm-hmm. And this one will be about virtual work experience. Mm-hmm. And we have with us Mr. Michael Cutter from Firetech UK, who will talk about how to have work experience virtually. So yes. Friends, please let
and
us.
And this is very interesting for mm-hmm. our TUET and university students who are seeking for the, you know, work experience during the COVID yes. pandemic, right? Mm-hmm. So they can see the model. How can they do it?
Okay, so let's enjoy.
Hello and welcome to Firetech Virtual Work Experience. My name is Michael Cotter. I'm Head of Learning Design at Firetech. We're going to talk you through our new program, which is about providing a far superior virtual work experience and learning for young people. I'm just going to share my screen. Great, in we go. Firetech's mission is all about empowering and inspiring young people to build a better world with technology. We want to fill them with a love for the potential and excitement of technology that enables them to go out and make a difference to the world and to their own lives and careers. And that end, we have been the UK's most popular provider of technology courses for young people for most of the last decade. And by technology courses, we mean learning about artificial intelligence, programming, coding, such as Python and Java, video game design, graphic design, digital music production, or even creating your own YouTube channel. And so these are fascinating new technology skills that kids absolutely love, and we've been at the forefront of delivering those for almost 10 years now. All of our learning is project-based, and that's a critical point to make. And so what the young people are doing is they're building the skills, but they're also creating something. They're emerge and finish with a project, something tangible in their hands that they can point to and reference and show people. Live tutoring is really important to Firetech. So we have live tutors who take the young people through the learning and are able to give the support and instruction that they need to succeed. And it can be quite intensive. It's possible that you really focus for quite a long time on this, but also we really design the experience to be fun and informal, and it's really important to us that young people have a great time doing the learning. And so a big part of this program is around a need or a problem that we all can see is around work experience. So Firetech is in the business of inspiring young people to use technology in their lives and in their careers and to be proficient and expert on it as soon as possible. Work experience is a really important component of young people's decision-making process about what they will do when they go forward in their lives. And yet, there's serious problems around it. It tends to be really difficult to organize good work experience, and often it's a poor quality experience. You're either perhaps stacking some shelves in an office or working the photocopier, and it's commonly reported to be possibly a little bit boring and maybe not entirely aligned to what the young person's objectives are. And difficult also if you're interested in the technology sector. How on earth, as a young person, would you access that sector? How would you enter it? How would you get your foot in the door? Very difficult. As our boss, Bill Hodges, the founder of Firetech, would say, why wait until the final years of your education to have great work experience? Why wait until the end of your university education to be going out into the world and trying to accumulate the experience that you need in order to get started in this world? So our objective with our virtual work experience program is that a young person can experience the tools, projects, teamwork, and the sort of feedback that you would get as if you walked in the door of a tech-focused business. What a wonderful thing. I would have absolutely loved it myself at the time. There are four elements to our program, being easy to remember, just four. Got a live boss. Tangible projects. Remember, I mentioned we're a project-based learning company. Tangible projects, real roles that you're selecting, and live teams to support you. So let's go through those quickly, one by one. So the Virtual Work Experience Program is not a course. It's not a set of slides or some videos that you watch and click through and answer some quizzes. It is real people doing genuine work, and you're led by a real boss or a mentor or a manager. So you meet them online and you discuss your aspirations in life or what your requirements are going to be. And choose a role for yourself in this program. It's a really important part of it. And your boss's job is to help you achieve the goals of the project, but also that you meet your own personal goals. It's really important that you're working on projects that are tangible and real and reflective of what you would actually experience in the real world. So, for example, in a video game design strand, you might make a prototype video game, or you might produce some designs to show to a client, or you might work on some gameplay issues, or you might think about the promotional campaign around that. So it's really important in doing that work that we give you exactly the same resources and work tools that you would use in that industry. How exciting is that? And also, if you need some support, we give you access to our own training platform, which is on Learn Worlds, and that enables you to build up the skills that you might need in order to do some of these pieces of work. Critical to the program is that you're selecting real roles. You're going to play your part in this team. And so within that, you've got your roles, and they might vary from, for example, on the video game design strand. You might be a coder or programmer, or you might be designing the gameplay, or you might be on the artistic side, developing the assets, the characters, the backgrounds, or the progression that the player is experiencing. So you're making choices around the role that what you're going to contribute to the team. Although young people being what they are, they may change their minds, and so we allow them to change roles at any point, which is a really interesting benefit. We all wish we could do that sometimes. And at the end, you get a skills report and your portfolio work and a professional reference that you might want to take into college applications or for job applications or just to add to your profile. A little bit more about the roles you can see within this team. For example, we've got a game designer strand and also a game artist strand. And so look at the things that the game designer is getting to do. They're working on the game story and logic based on the client brief, designing the rules of gameplay, coming up with ways of winning and losing the game. And that's going to involve a lot of problem solving and creativity. And as you can imagine, that is exactly the sort of work that they would be doing in their genuine video game design organization. Alternatively, you can work more on the artistic side. You know, it's all about the presentation, these things, the characters, the backgrounds, how the information is communicated to the player is really important. So you're going to be building a lot of your art and design skills and your storytelling skills as examples. In order to occupy a role, that's based on the conversation that you have with your boss at the beginning, and the boss takes in these inputs from the various team members and structures a team role around that to try and be successful. If you do want to change, that is a liaison with the boss, but often the project goals remain, and so tasks get redistributed, which is the same for all of us in work. You know, that's part of our own working lives, and so we're just sharing that aspect of that with the people. Live team. So you're working with teammates. You know, you're going to develop relationships, working relationships with these people. They will depend upon you, and they will support you and give you lots of brilliant help. Celebrate your successes together, and We provide all the normal business tools that you would expect around email and chat support in order to get things done. But these are young people, and so it's really key that we have proper safeguarding procedures. So all communications and video conferencing, etc., is recorded and archived for safety. Some of the tools that the young people are exposed to, Kanban boards for structuring and organizing your project, or improvement grids, you know, how can I iterate and improve on all my ideas, and idea matrix, you know, where you're judging the benefits versus the efforts of the work that you're doing. These are all very standard business tools that these young people now get to experience. We use Miro as a platform for that, and lots of flexibility around the sort of great things that they can use in order to record their work and present it. We mentioned about the skills report. What we're looking to do is report to the young person about the development of their technical skills, maybe in the creative design side, perhaps the sort of their ability to use Photoshop or many of the features on that, and also their soft skills around leadership or time management or problem solving. So we present that in a really nice certificate towards the end. They can use that for their portfolio or for their applications. Virtual work experience comes in five phases, and so although it is possible to do it in 5 days or 5 weeks, there are five distinct phases that we've broken into. And so the first of those is the research phase, where, as you can imagine, you're coming together with your team, receiving the brief and starting to research some of the possible solutions to that. Next, you're brainstorming your ideas. How might you tackle the brief? How might you really make it sing? And planning your next steps. Then you're trying to build a solution. Then you're trying to take your ideas, create something, assemble them into something exciting that works. Next, you're going to improve that. You're going to do a little bit of presentation to see, is your solution in the real realms of what's required, and make improvements to that. And finally, you're presenting your project or your ideas to a panel from the industry and taking feedback from that, learning from that. It's a critical part of the experience. And then you're finished. Then you get your report, celebrate the great times you had as a team, and have great memories. With two strands, a video game design strand and a creative design studio strand at the moment, and upcoming are join a tech startup and imagine what it would like joining a global tech brand. So the sort of things that you could be working on, that sort of organization. Fantastic. For young people age 15 to 19, critically, obviously, they're thinking about a tech career. They do tend to want to have some knowledge of the subject in the first place, and prepared to give a sort of a minimum time commitment of that kind of time, 20 to 25 hours, although young people in what they are, if they get really excited about it, may give a lot more time. This program is running in the UK right now, and in the summer of this year, we are running it for 200 students in Oman, and then we're in negotiations with various other regions around the world and with corporates. There we go. Our virtual work experience program, as you can see there. If you want any more information, please come to our website, and I absolutely welcome emails direct to me at michael@firetech.com, and look forward to hearing from you. So thank you very much for your time.
Wow, thank you very much for the very interesting video and the expertise that sharing from our partners. Yes. And there are many participants asking us that how they could access the video again.
I think and the QR code.
And QR code from Vedo. And link from the other partners, right?
Right.
So we will pin the link of the SEAMEO lecture series website on the chat box so that they can visit and download the video one by one that they interest. And also, if you can go back again, right, to see the YouTube they can capture.
Yes, and I think our colleagues have already pinned. So if those who are watching us online, you can access the link. It is already pinned. So if you want to get a copy of the videos, any specific videos that they are interested in, we have pinned the location where they can access the files.
That's right. And then this includes the previous session on 28th January and 4th February.
Yes. So please feel free to access that. And I guess that's it for the SEAMEO Partners lecture series. So we'd like to thank all our partners who have freely shared their expertise, their innovations to our participants so that we can all benefit and learn from their offerings.
That's right.
And then at this point, you might be wondering, so what's next? So every Thursday is a SEAMEO Learning Thursday for most of our participants. So at this point, we'd like to share with you the upcoming events of SEAMEO. And now this is our offering to them.
That's right.
So first is the SEAMEO Congress 2021. You can see the QR code there. The link is also there. On the left part of the screen, you can see the dates, and then it's for free. So we have also prepared the video for you. So please let us all watch this video.
And we would like to welcome the educators and students to participate in our SEAMEO Congress, right?
Yes.
So there are two parts that you can participate as a participant, you know, and they can scan this QR code and fill up the personal information, and then they will get the link to join our SEAMEO Congress. So please note that on your calendar that on 28th and 29th April this year, so you need to make yourself free and available for the SEAMEO Congress. And this is a part of the as a participant.
And the registration is free.
Yes, that's right. The registration is free for all, even if you're from the Southeast Asian country or from the country around the world or beyond, you know, you can enter and for the free registration. And we welcome, and we don't have limitation,
no
right?
No limitations.
We open for all to join our SEAMEO Congress in virtual format.
So to those who are watching us on playback, all the 5,000 plus of you and those on live, more than 800, who are interested to join us, please access the link.
Yes, that's right. And then our team will pin the registration link on the chat box of the YouTube channel.
Yes, already pinned.
Yes, that's great. And then for the next participation is for the educators or teacher or lecturers who want to present the paper or their research paper in the our SEAMEO Congress. They can visit our website and click on the abstract submission, and then you can submit the paper or whatever research that you already have in hand And, you know, and we have the committee to select the good paper to be presented at the Congress. Mm-hmm. And the deadline is on the 5th March.
So that's
next 2 weeks.
2 weeks from now. So if you're interested to join us as a speaker, please access those links and submit your abstracts to us.
Yes, and that is no fee to charge them, right?
Yes.
So everything is free for all the educators and students to participate as the participant and also paper presentations.
Okay.
And the next one. So we also would like to invite all the educational institutions to join in our SEAMEO school networks. So primary education, kindergarten, secondary, vocational school, and also university mm-hmm. can join us. Even you are from the non-formal education, you can scan QR code and then you represent the institution to apply. And then you put the detail of the focal persons. Mm-hmm. And then you will receive the new scholarships, information of the training programs,
yes.
you know, from the SEAMEO regularly. And then at the moment, we have 1,009 institutions as our members. So we welcome other countries like Brunei, Cambodia, Laos, PDR to join us as well. Okay, for the next program, Rafi.
Yeah. So just an announcement from SEAMEO-Partners Network will be celebrating the 55th founding anniversary. We are inviting everyone to join the competitions. First, the essay contest for students. Open for primary junior high school students from the 11 Southeast Asian countries. And the deadline for this is on May 30, 2021. SEAMEO-Partners Network is also looking for Innovation on School Health Initiatives Award. So this one, we're looking for proposals and the deadline to submit the proposals would be June 30, 2021. I know you have a lot of questions, but for more info, you may visit the website www.seniortropmednetwork.org or you may email the focal person. It's dangdan_il@hotmail.com. So we urge everyone to join this competition.
That is a timely topic, right?
Yes.
During the COVID pandemic.
Also, we're inviting everyone, particularly since this is our last session, you might be wondering what's next after this session for the SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series. So please follow us. I know that all of you are following us on YouTube, on Facebook, but please also follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @SEAMEO_S, or you can just simply search SEAMEO Secretariat on the Twitter account.
And the last question everybody asked for.
Yeah, it has been posed so many times now. So
how can you get the certificate,
yes,
right?
Please do the honors. Yeah.
Yes, and you can scan QR code and the link, and then please be mind that this certificate link will be closed at 12 o'clock at noon. And please ensure the spelling of full name, email address, and please bear for us because now we have about 7,000 requests for the certificate from
and that
the,
was just the previous
last,
week.
Yeah, from the previous week of the lecture series. And it takes time for us to generate the certificate mm-hmm. to the participant, and
right.
it will be about 1 month for mm-hmm. the generating. So please be patient with us. And many participants ask that how can they get the link? It's so easy that, you know, we will pin the link for the certificate on the chat box. Okay, everybody see the link on the chat box on the top. So you can click on the link and register for the certificate request. Mm-hmm. And another two channel from Facebook, you just, you know, hashtag SEAMEO-Partners, and then you will see the link for today's mm-hmm. session. And the Facebook account as well, you just search for SEAMEO Secretariat, right? Mm-hmm. And then you will see the link for the certificate of today's session. Okay, I think that's
all for this SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series. It's been a pleasure seeing every one of you every Thursday for the last 3 or 4 Thursdays, and that includes the SCUBA symposium the other Thursday. So,
and we would like to thank a lot to our 20 partners who join and mm-hmm. share their expertise mm-hmm. and their offering to our Southeast Asian participants.
Yes,
right?
Yes, from all over the globe, from Asia, Europe, US, from all over. So we truly appreciate the time and the effort exerted in reaching out.
Yes. And also, we would like to thank the participation of our Southeast Asian educators and mm-hmm. students and beyond who join in our YouTube Live,
yes.
which we have about over 10,000 participants mm-hmm. altogether already. And thank you very much for your participation with us. And please keep in touch with us for the mm-hmm. next program.
So from all of us here in the Senior Secretariat headquarters in Bangkok, Thailand, we wish you all a happy learning and we hope to see you in the future learning events that we will be organizing.
Yes, stay safe and be healthy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All our dreams.